Today's culture is inundating us with advertising everywhere we look.
Think about it. Everything from the biggest decisions you'll make to the basic day-to-day.
Like which college to attend, which car to buy, or which company to work for.
Or even which toothpaste gives the greatest shine.
Let's admit it. It's a lot of work to sort through all this data.
And most companies aren't doing much to help.
The root issue is our businesses have become so focused on what this book calls the what.
Generally, we'll focus on factors like product features or performance data.
So what's the key to breaking information overload?
The answer is turning to the why.
So let's jump right in here to Simon Sinek's book, Start With Why, How Great Leaders Inspire Everyone to Take Action. Welcome back. You're listening to Motivation Minute. Every week, we unravel the timeless truths hiding in that stack of books you've been wanting to read so that you don't have to. And today's book is Start With Why. And Jiraiya, it is our second book by Simon Sinek. The first was Leaders Eat Last, right?
Yep, when we had our good friend Stephen Jarrett on for that podcast.
That's right.
The TEDx talk that Simon Sinek did is the third most viewed TEDx talk of all time. It has like 25 million views.
And that's incredible.
And this book is based, I think, on that TEDx talk or the same topic, which is Start With Why.
So how about we jump right into what do we mean by start with why? So our sales techniques today are very manipulative. Like everything you consider, we were mentioning in the Motivation Minute earlier how everything from the college you go to, the car you buy, the insurance company you work with, down to your toothpaste, like the goal is to win a sale, not a loyal relationship. And the reason is we just keep selling the what.
Yeah, I think people focus on why their product is so good or just focus on the product itself when, effective marketing and everything is based on the whole kind of culture or the whole kind of identity of a company, which is like, you know, what they believe in or what you associate that company with when you think about it. So it's so much deeper than just how good they are, you know, the what or how their product works, but it's the why. And yeah, I think you're definitely right. There's something so much deeper that we don't think about. It's in our subconscious that is why we make decisions. And it's not based on the facts and the figures, but
yeah,
on why the emotion involved that makes us feel a certain way when we think about certain products.
And on that note of facts and figures, you know, when you're dealing with a decision, the hardest part is they give you so much data often because you're comparing products based on their features. But seeing things just based on, you know, how much space they have, like you were telling me you just bought a new phone today. You're in the Verizon store. And they're showing you a bunch of different phones. Now, you were sold. You're getting the iPhone XS. But see, you saw all these phones there that were, you know, saying, I have this much capacity of storage. My camera is this many megapixels. And, you know, on and on the list goes. How do you even make a decision? We're so focused on the what of things, like the features you can compare, not on the why.
Well, you know, it's funny. You'll see people argue over phones, and I do this a lot too, or I used to more. You know, the iPhone's better, and then we're like, oh, it's better. Well, you know, it's better because of the cameras. This camera's better. This thing's better. Or, you know, it's faster. It has more memory. But at the end of the day, we don't buy phones or anything based on because it has the best features. And there were some other phones in the Verizon store that were probably had better specs. I'm guessing the Samsung S9 has some better specs than the iPhone.
Yeah, I mean, I respect the people that have those phones, but I am an iPhone user as well because Apple, through everything they do, try to sell not a product, but a lifestyle.
Yeah, really do.
I mean, if you take the bait, you'll get the watch. And I was just reading an article that the watch is the gateway to the iPhone. And then the iPhone is kind of like, well, maybe if you have an iPhone, then you want a Mac because it's so, you know, syncs with it and is very convenient. Then once you have a Mac, you're like, I need more power. You get an iMac. And it just keeps going like that.
Yeah. Well, I think the same can be true sometimes for any product, but I've seen it with Android users too. You know, I think Android phones make people feel a little bit more like a rebel maybe sometimes. I think whatever product, the reason we buy certain products is because they make us feel a certain way, you know, not based on the features. Because, you know, we'll sit there and argue features, which is the best one. But at the end of the day, we're stuck in our mind of which one we like more. You know, we're really stubborn. And it's because we like a certain company just because we like it, because it makes us feel a certain way. We already make up our minds long before we even know what the specs are, you know, what the features are.
I like how you said we like it just because we like it. Like, sometimes we can't even explain why it is. And that is the way it is with a story sometimes, because the way a story works, it kind of captivates you, pulls you into the point where you're like, I don't even know why I like this, but there's something that draws me to this product because of the way it's presented, or the way it integrates with other products, or the story the company wraps that product around.
Yeah.
You think about like Southwest Airlines. So they've thrived on their unique service and on their open seating and getting people on budget flights with short times. Well, there were competitors like TED that United started, or Song. And those were airlines that tried to do the same thing, but they suffered. Why? They didn't tell a story. They didn't have a why.
There's a quote, you know, it says in the book, it says, people don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it. Same with not just a product, but buying anything, as in buying onto somebody's concept, or if you're trying to hire employees. That's the difference between, you know, the classic example of somebody that just wants a paycheck. They're doing it for the money, the what. I get money, so I'll work here.
Well, and part of the issue is that's how the jobs are organized. Like, you get a job posting that says, here's how you're going to be qualified. Here's what we expect of you. You don't get in the job posting like about the company culture.
Yeah.
And that's why people are dissatisfied.
Definitely. I mean, I think it is the way that people will look for employees. Big companies will just hire people who need jobs. You know, it says if you hire people who need a job, you'll get people who work for your money. If you hire people who believe what you believe, they'll work for you with blood, sweat, and tears. If they have the same vision, if they have the same motivation, the same drive that you do, they have the same, they believe in the same things you do as far as what's possible and the, you know, what's coming in the future. They're you know, if they believe the same things you do, they're a part of your team. They're not just working for a paycheck.
Yeah, and the book was saying, like, don't pay people to create ideas. Pay people so that they work in an environment where great ideas thrive. Because then they'll make the ideas rather than being forced to create them with the high salary that you're expecting them to create ideas from at that caliber.
Yeah, well, we just can't do anything that we don't really believe in. We all know the famous speech, the I Have a Plan speech by Martin Luther King. Oh wait, that was I Have a Dream, not I Have a Plan. you know, he talked about how much, you know, like what he believed, and people came to hear him speak because of what he believed, not because he just said, you know, oh, these politicians are bad and this country is in the wrong direction and this is, he didn't just talk about the facts and what's wrong or what's right. He talked about how much, you know, how he believed in a higher purpose and how the laws of man need to align with the laws of God and different things that were just so much deeper, and people believed in what he believed, you know. And then also in the TEDx talk, I think also in the book, he talked about the Wright brothers, and there's countless examples of companies that started that were underfunded, that did not have the resources available that somebody else had, you know. Everything was working against them, but still they succeeded. The Wright brothers are a good example, because there was another guy named Samuel Langley, I believe, that was given, you know, millions of dollars in today's money to invent the flying machine. Mm-hmm. And, you know, but he was trying to get rich and famous, basically. And he had, you know, he had all the support he could possibly want, but he wasn't successful in that. The Wright brothers were. They were so passionate about the flying machine, and they believed it would change the world, whereas Samuel Langley just, you know, basically wanted to get rich and famous.
That reminds me of a great little book I read this week about how, like, you can do more with less, like the Wright brothers. It was this book, Acres of Diamonds. You can find things that are a lot less costly. Like, you don't get paid the high salary to create the ideas, like being the guy who creates the flying machine because he's paid the most. If you can create a flying machine with less, like investing less money and showing you can do a lot with little money, that's a huge skill.
Yeah, that just goes to show that it's not the people who are the most funded or who have the most privileged or benefits that actually create big things in the world. It's people who have extraordinary belief in something or drive or motivation or something. That's how you end up being successful in something, not being funded. But we all use the excuse of, oh, you know, just that person was born with the, you know, lucky or privilege, or they had more money or whatever. That's why they're successful. But at the end of the day, that's not why people are successful. The reason that they're successful is because of the of why they do what they do. Yeah, what motivates them.
And overpaying can make you appear like you're a liar, basically. Because, like, so Walmart CEO in 2009, the book was saying, took a $5.5 million salary when Sam Walton only took $450,000 at his maximum. But this new CEO is trying to restore Walmart's original purpose. That's not going to work if you take the big money for that. You have to actually make a statement from the top that you want to initiate that process. Wow.
Yeah, that's amazing. I remember there was a company, I forgot what company it was, but the CEO said he would only take a $1 a year salary. And it inspired so many other managers and people in the company to do the same. And that takes a lot of work to get people to voluntarily cut their pay. But apparently he did it because I can't remember the cause or the mission. But you got tons of people to cut their pay because he did it. Because they believed in the cause.
Well, yeah, and from like a business owner perspective for you, I mean, you've got part-time employees working for you now. You're not the richest guy in the world. And if you were and you were paying them pennies in comparison, there'd be some giant gap.
Yeah.
That it would be very clear versus paying what they're worth and then paying yourself what you're worth and being honest about that whole process.
Yeah. You know, not that you don't want to pay people a lot. You want to pay people as much as you possibly can and what's fair. But, you know, if you are a great leader and you believe in a purpose, people will work for you and they won't expect a huge paycheck, or they won't be entitled. They'll want to help grow the company and the mission, and they'll be in there for the long run. And, you know, I really want to be able to do that.
Yeah.
You know, it said in the book, instead of relying on big paychecks, threatening deadlines, or highly qualified graduates, look for people who are already motivated by the same reasons as you and inspire them even more.
Yes. And the problem is most of these companies don't have reasons they're motivated because they keep looking for the people that have all the skill, and you put people with a lot of skill together and no motivation, you're not going to get that far even though you're super qualified.
Yeah, look, I think secretly you talk to any employer of any, most, you know, of most businesses, they would say they would hire a young kid that doesn't have a college degree or experience, but is very willing to work and he'll be there, stay there late, he'll show up early, he'll do the extra job, go above and beyond. They'll hire that guy above a more qualified person that's just there for the paycheck. One example that I've learned in my business, or any business that you have that you can apply this if you're trying to sell something, is, you know, don't just state what you do. Like if somebody asks what you do for a business, you know, you'll say, oh, you know, I have a baker shop and we bake cookies, or we, you know, or for me, it's the video business. So, you know, what I'll generally say or have said is, you know, I'll make videos for people, but that's very kind of boring or whatever. If you just state what you do, the obvious, whatever you're doing as a profession, if you could take the result of what you do and tell that to people. So if somebody asks me what I'll do, I'll try to say something like, you know, I help people get more customers.
Through the avenue of video.
Yeah, I'll help them get more customers and spread their message, which helps them generate more business and more revenue in their business. And I happen to do that with video. You know,
I like that.
That's a lot more exciting.
Well, and you're digging down to the story, because if you don't tell people why you're there, they're like, why should I go with you versus the other guy down the street that's doing video too?
Exactly.
Like, what is it that you provide that's unique? And that's what differentiates you. You got a story.
Yeah, like you hear the Apple ads. They don't say, you know, we build amazing computers. They're beautifully designed, easy to use. They're simple, blah, blah, blah. No, they start with the why. They'll say it's, we believe in standard,
right,
in, you know, challenging the status quo. And we believe everything has to start from its most simple element or something, whatever they say.
Yeah, I love these ads.
And then they at the end, they'll say, and here's the new iPhone after they've already. So by the end, by the time they talk about what they're actually selling, you're already sold. Whereas you first, it's like getting to the punchline too soon. You're like, here's the new iPhone. And you're like, okay, there it is. And then you talk about it. No, it's first you have a buildup of like, this is why we make the iPhone, and this is why our stuff is better. This is why it's different. And then you say, here's the new iPhone, you know, whatever.
It's almost like showing people, why should I care? Because you go in wondering, so what do you have that anyone else doesn't have? And the person says, well, I have this. They're like, well, someone else has that. But if you show them the why of your story, then pretty much any story is unique. So I think my number one takeaway from this whole book is that concept of state your result first and then why you're getting to that result.
Or how
that result. Right. Because you want to be going in the right order, and people are more receptive to what you have to give if you start explaining why you're going that direction versus just saying, here's the thing. People appreciate a story. When you think about a speaker on stage, you remember their stories, not what they said all the time.
Yeah, that's the thing. You remember when you have a conversation with somebody, like it did in the book. I think it was the book Never Eat Alone. In that book, it talked about how you, when you have a conversation with somebody, you remember the feeling that you had, how they made you feel. You don't remember what you actually talked about. So yeah, it's how it is in so many things. We forget a lot of the details and the facts and the specifics, but we remember how we felt. And, you know, we should come up with something for our podcast of, you know, why we're doing the podcast. We could say, when people ask us what we do, you know, it's easy just to say,
we do
a podcast. We talk about books, business ideas, blah, 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 boring. You know, if you talked about, you know, we're trying to motivate people, inspire people to, you know, to
read
start
the
their
books
business.
That they haven't been reading and start businesses through a podcast.
Exactly. Through a podcast, yeah.
Like, that's the last thing. That's a cool idea.
Also, if you're writing something, you can make it more interesting by talking about the why first.
Yeah, like a good technique when you're writing a paper is in the introduction to explain why you should care about this paper. Otherwise, you'll lose the reader's attention if you jump right to the point.
I'm sure it works in marketing, in emails, or whatever you're selling at, talking about the results first.
So start with why, an excellent book. And to get more like this episode, we do one like this every week. You can just tap that subscribe button on your app. And we're taking a survey these days. We want to figure out the books you want to read, because that's what we really care about. We've actually got some really cool responses that have come in, and I've already got them on my way to my library. So stay tuned for those. Hey, I just checked the podcast app, and we have two new reviews from the last week. So shout out to MJ and Andy Ferris, who left reviews. That's really cool you guys did that. We really appreciate it. All the effort you guys put in to write that and give us a rating helps us out a ton.
Yeah, we really appreciate reviews for sure. And you will be, since you've left a review, you guys are going to be put into the contest to receive a free book, or if you'd want to be featured on the podcast, you'd be welcome to do that as well.
And anyone else, if you're feeling like you're missing out on this free drawing, well, all you gotta do is leave a review. Just go to motivationminute.com and tap that review button, and it'll bring you right to our iTunes page. So we'd love to hear from you. Thanks, guys. I appreciate you listening. We'll see you again next week.